just want to talk a bit about New York and Rivington, where I met you.
Right.
The practice space. Man, everything happened in that place.
Water, you better come there with some. That's not a tourist spot.
No, that's not a tourist spot. That's a serious joint.
Man, at that time, man, we had so many cats there. Like Kenny Kirkland, Jeff Payne, George Coleman Jr., Jojo Meyer was Ben Fauci, Adam Holzman, Van Romaine, Fema Ephraim, Dave Binney, Andreas Valentini.
Wow.
Blood, sweat, and tears.
You know what? Like, both you and Ben called me about available space in there.
Really?
You, because you're the guy who was in the room with you had split, and Ben Prowski had called me. And both times, like the place I was, I could play. You know, I could practice full out. I was really lucky, you know. But here's the thing. I kind of wish I had taken one of the spaces just for the hang.
Amazing, man. 24 hours, you know.
Yeah.
But of course, back then, it was a little sketchy.
Yeah, it was a little rough, but, you know.
There was prostitution upstairs on one end of the corner. They were selling whatever.
Something.
Blow, herb. I don't know, but a lot of stuff was going on.
It was intense. I remember that.
Do your thing, where y'all just let me get this door.
Right.
But it was like guns or anything, so.
Yeah.
And then remember, there's a Spanish restaurant across the street.
We've eaten there. Yeah, I remember.
Yeah. Now, one day I was bringing my drums out to go to a gig. You know, get a taxi. Bring the drums out, put them on the sidewalk, and run to the corner, get a taxi, bring them past the drums. Usually, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, I got a taxi. But for some reason, no taxis for like 50 minutes. And now I'm panicking.
Oh.
Now I'm worried. Like, oh, man. My gig is like up at 26th and 21st and 7th Avenue, I believe. Mm-hmm. The Angry Squire, something like that. And so, just so happened, as I'm panicking on the sidewalk, running back and forth from block to block, these two policemen love to take a break there, as you remember. They some dinner at that Spanish restaurant. Two policemen come out, and one looks over at me and goes, hey, man, you're a drummer, huh? And I was so stressed out at that time, I almost answered sarcastically, like, no, I'm a beautician. What do you think? But I held it in, bit my lip, and said, yeah, I'm a drummer. And then everything else just poured out, the verbiage. I'm late for it. I've been going back and forth.
Yeah. And,
So far, so good. We need to pull up. Anyway, so I said, I explained to both officers, I said, getting into that car.
That's intense. This is perfect background sound, too. I love it. This is perfect.
And it disappeared into the storm.
I know.
Hold up your feet. Three suits fell down. A car was crushed. So, coming out of this restaurant, these all over, and they say, look, why don't you just put your drums in our car?
What? In the cop car?
And they say, yeah, come on, we'll help you. They help put the drums in the trunk, the back seat. I'm sitting in the back seat, I'm sitting in the front. And away we go. Like the thunder of a storm.
Right.
Blazing up 6th Avenue with the sirens and lights going, man. We must have been going like almost 80, probably like 80. And as we're riding, going over the potholes and 16th Street, 17th Street, 18th Street, 19th Street, 20th Street. One of the officer riding shotgun turns around and goes, "Aren't you Tommy Campbell?"
Oh,
I'm thinking about everything that I did.
Yeah, what did I do? Like, what? Oh, no.
Yeah, okay. Yes, I am. Yes. Why do you ask, officer?
Yeah.
And he said, "I am Thunder."
That's what he said, right?
"I'm a drummer." He said, "I'm a drummer, man. I got Zildjian Day and I've
Wow. So it was a thrill for him.
Yeah, he said, "I know you play Zildjian and
wow.
And drum, yeah.
And amazing.
And so we're riding along and I'm sitting in the back going, "Officers, this is the only way I want to be in this car." Thank you. I'm going to be about 5 minutes late showing up. When we get to the club, the officers, they get out, and as we open the door, they said, "Look, if you really want to mess with the band, we'll bring you in. We'll bring the drums in. You can just come in with your hands behind your back." We come in, officers carrying my drum, got my hand behind my back. Right away, the lead singer goes, "Oh my God!" And the bass player's on the stage, you know, laughing. Oh man.
That is the best. Incredible. Wow. So, before we keep going, you lived in Tokyo for about 13, 14 years, right?
14 years.
Wow. In fact, I visited Tokyo and saw, and we hung out there.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. On my head. Right.
Yeah. Sat in and everything. It was fantastic. So, well, I guess you had gotten married. Is that why you moved there, or?
Out front in Point Blank, I kind of ran myself ragged in New York. I played everywhere from Carnegie Hall to Zinfar and what have you. With Sonny Rollins and a lot of New York groups. Time for a change.
Right.
I felt like I was going around in the circle seeing the same people. Next best thing I ever did, man. Loved it. I had a platonic relationship with a half black, half Japanese woman there for 7 years. Because I've been going to Japan way before I moved there.
Yeah.
So now Watanabe kind of co-signed me to along with a friend, June Saito, who's a close friend of mine, who also moved back to Japan. You know, it all kind of came together at once. I had a tour there with Sadao. Me and my girlfriend then, we both kind of hooked up. She moved from Osaka, I moved from New York into Tokyo. We got an apartment. One thing led to another, we got married. I had at least 4 bands in Japan. I mean, they, you know, just like anywhere, this is another thing I learned about countries and people. Like
gigs in Tokyo must have been great.
In Tokyo, just in Tokyo alone, there's over 250 live houses.
Whoa. Where,
just in Tokyo. They love music, man. There's more Japanese music students than anywhere else in any country. They have more, Japan has more music students taking an instrument more than anywhere in any other country.
Wow.
Their music is everywhere. They love it. They love black music, white music, blue music. Mm-hmm. You can find clicks of, you know.
Of whatever, yeah.
They love gospel.
Wow.
And I think with a lot of people that were coming over and felt that they could do it with me rather than fly their own drummer. People like Christian McBride, for example, from Christian McBride to the Backstreet Boys. You know, and all in between.
Wow.
A lot of Japanese artists that are super famous, you know. You got a Japanese Willie Nelson, you got a Japanese James Brown, you got a Japanese Dolly Parton, you got a Japanese Beyonce, you got a Japanese Britney Spears, you know, got a Japanese Madonna for sure. You got a Japanese they love Latin music.
Mm-hmm.
There's a Latin group, Japanese Latin group called
it's like Tito Puente or something, like.
Oh man, they are deep into it. They study, you know, they study. Orchestra de la Luz.
Oh, okay.
The Japanese jazz Latin group, and they learn from all of the greats, including New York musicians as well as Cuba,
right.
and Africa. And one time they came to New York to perform, you know, to kind of get an opinion. So how are we, you know? Mm-hmm. And they, of course, they speak fluent Spanish. The Japanese people, you know, speak Spanish, but learn the music.
Yeah.
They know the music up and down. And they one time came to the Bronx from Japan and performed their concert. Because Japanese, you know, they have backing, you know.
So yeah, they get money.
Concert. And people from the Bronx, Latinos from the Bronx, like, what's going on here?
Right.
They were blown away, basically, overall. They were like, what?
Right.
Yeah.
Crazy.
And so, to make a long story short, those New York musicians co-signed, you know, Orchestra de la Luz.
Mm-hmm.
All televised in Japan, and so
wow,
and they were the same, you know.
Yeah.
So, amazing. And that branched off, you know.
Right.
So they had a Latin community, boy, and the Brazilian community, and the European jazz community,
crazy,
star community, you know, and clubs, and venues to go with it. Oh yeah, old jazz, new jazz, you know. So, they had soul clubs, you know.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So it was there. And being a foreigner, you could kind of analyze what you're doing, you know, look at
right.
it from a viewpoint, you know.
Right.
It was very.
That's incredible.
It was there. Of course, the food was amazing.
Yeah.
But any food from home, you had to pay.
More, yeah. Yeah, but the food there is great, so.
Absolutely.
You know, that's
and
bad.
Because I had big feet and long legs, and I traveled a lot. I still traveled a lot to Japan. I went back and forth to New York. To Europe, you know, to other countries.
The other side, Indonesia.
But other things in Japan, man, just drumming-wise, it's very interesting.
Okay.
You know, Japan takes pride in their products. Green tea, rice, vegetables, bamboo. I played in this band. I was a guest drummer of this guy who has a band, and he made all of the instruments in the band out of bamboo. Xylophones.
Whoa.
What else did he have? Everything, even a guitar, and of course the drum set, everything bamboo.
Wow.
Bass drum bamboo, the hi-hats, even the cymbals were bamboo, everything was bamboo. Yeah, the drums, you had low toms, high toms, pedal was bamboo. Everything was made from bamboo.
Nuts.
The drum set. The bell of the cymbal, you know, all, everything made of bamboo.
That's crazy.
It was so weird, man.
What did that sound? You played it? You played this?
Yeah, concerts and everything, yeah. It was very interesting.
Okay, yeah, I was going to say.
I was only doing it one time for like $3,000 or something crazy.
So sure I'll do it. Wow. That's hilarious.
That's on the weird side, but on the really, you know,
the artistic side.
A lot of good musicians there.
Yeah. Again, I thank you for hanging with me so long today. I want to come back to the... Well, actually, this may have started in Japan, but we mentioned it earlier. The Porkestra.
The Porkestra.
One of my favorite things that I've seen you do. Obviously, a byproduct, again, from Dizzy Gillespie. Entertainment and playing. And the thing I notice about the Porkestra is, yes, it's great entertainment, people love it, but underneath it, you are playing some very serious drums.
Yes.
And so like musicians can hear what's happening underneath, and then the lay people on top just find it great, you know. So talk to me about the Porkestra. How did that come together?
One thing leads to another. When you're a drummer, of course, you know, we're creative, blah, 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 of course. You know, we've done everything from the hand bone and the claps and, you know, hitting walls and sidewalks and paint cans and ceilings and
sure.
And
beat.
You know.
Right.
Batman style bang, too. And so,
right.
You know, we mess around with certain things anyway. You know, I was a new father. My son was about 2 years old. I'm in a toy store, in the dollar store, which is called the Yahoo In Shop.
Okay.
Yahoo means 100 in yen. Mm-hmm. And trying to buy something for my son that's not too dangerous and that can make a little sound. Sure enough, I came across a toy that I still have to this day. It's the first member of the Porkestra. This alligator is for a dollar. And I was taken to the cashier and it fell on the floor. And at the same time it fell on the floor, it made a sound. And then I stepped on it. I rolled on it with my foot.
Right.
And for some reason, somebody just told me, you know what, man? That's not for your son. That's for you.
That's yours.
I took it to my gig that night. Didn't know what I was going to do with it, and just saw and just. I looked over at my hi hat, and
right.
it was like this. Hi, how you doing?
Inviting.
And so I just went put the alligator in there.
Uh-huh.
You know, and realized that. I don't know.
Going on.
That's the beginning of it.
Amazing.
Then, and also that same day, I bought a cashier's bill, which is a dollar.
Mm-hmm.
Ding, you know, service bill.
Right.
I put that on the right of my bass drum pedal.
Uh-huh.
And for those quiet moments, and depending what pitch it was, you know, I could use it, you know.
Right.
And everybody listened so well, you know. In their way, I should say, any good audience, you know,
right,
audience,
sure.
You're known for it. And when it's quiet, mm-hmm. You can't. So, mm-hmm. And that bell, ding, ring, you know, so.
Yeah.
And then, of course, it was a hit with the audience. So I went back to the dollar store.
Get more stuff.
And, got and found a frog that made a little noise, but it was pretty. You know, in Japan, fish and stuff. So I put that on the floor. And then so it was kind of coming together. You know, I would use it sparingly. I wasn't forcing it, you know. In jazz, and if you have a nice array of music, you know, there's always room for jello, you know? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, one day, a customer or a friend knew what I was doing and brought to the gig a pig for me. Kind of looked like that.
Okay.
And, you know, easy found a way to play that, you know. And that just started to grow, I guess. And, you know, I was there 13 years, so I probably had a good 10 pigs. seven pigs, a duck, the alligator, of course, the cashier's bell.
Wow.
A frog. And in Japan, I would lay them on the floor as decoration around the drums.
Oh, okay. See?
So I played a lot of them with my feet, except for the alligator.
Uh-huh.
Just be on the floor, you know, being pretty, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, starting up to here, to the present, as I'm leaving Japan now, this is after 9/11 and 3/11, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. and I'm leaving Japan. I actually stopped through January, so I stopped through L.A. and visited the NAMM show to let all my endorsement people and friends
mm-hmm.
know that, hey, I'm back in New York now. You know, don't look to the, over the
city. Yeah, another way, right.
Pearl Drums was the only company that didn't give me the time of day. They basically said, we don't care where you're at, man. You know, we don't have time for you. We don't have room for you.
Really?
Yep. It was a no-brainer. I said, you know what? Let's be friends. I'm out.
Wow. Yeah, and that's that.
Yeah. And then I said, now I can play other drums without feeling guilty.
Right.
I pretty much always been Zildjian, Evans, Big Bird. But the drums, you know, I basically signed with Pearl because they were all over the world and I was traveling all over the world, so I could get a lot of rentals.
Right.
But if you endorse, you know, those obscure drum companies, even like Slingerland or Ludwig, maybe Ludwig with Ludwig Smith is so old, but, mm-hmm. and you're playing in Siberia.
Good luck.
You know. I don't think they're going to use it. Hello, can you have a drum set delivered to Liberia?
Yeah.
Yeah, right away.
I'll get right on that.
You're on your own. A lot of young drummers don't know that. You know, companies can only go a certain distance with you. You build your own relationship. I've had great relationships. Big first signed me, you know. He used to bring his sticks. Prototypes to my gigs at Who's Pub. And Tommy, check these out, you know.
Right.
So I was lucky to hang with Armin Zildjian.
Wow, yeah, that's great.
Lenny DiMuzio, man. And later to follow John DeChristopher and Colin Schofield, Terry DeSanto. Oh, man.
Yeah.
Really great times. And they kept me afloat, and I guess I was keeping them, not afloat, but informed.
Right.
So that was really good. So moving along, well, now it's time to move back to New York, where the sirens are always blazing and thunderstorms are always storming.
Exactly.
So now there was no way I was going to bring these pigs and animals to New York.
Okay, it's like, okay, that was that. That's over.
I left all of those toys in Japan.
Mm-hmm.
As I went to the airport, I left everything in Japan. I gave it away, you know, the presents, you know, or threw it away, you know.
Right.
Threw them away. I was the only one who, at that time, knew what to do with it.
Mm-hmm.
When I get to the airport to fly to America,
mm-hmm.
some of my fans showed up at the airport to see me off, and sure enough, they brought some things. number even. And I'm like, oh my God.
You gotta be kidding me.
So I'm bringing pigs not only to America, but on the plane with me, not even checks, luggage. Oh, and so I get to New York, of course, and I gotta say this real quick, and that is, I get to New York and I run into a great friend, Craig Handy. Mm-hmm. You know, we played the biggest band together.
Right.
And, run into him, and I'm like, first day in New York, man, I gotta go hang out, and I got a very limited budget. Mm-hmm. I gotta hang out. Craig, you wanna hang out? So he said, okay, man, I'll hang out with you. I said, where you wanna go? He said, how about Smoke up on Broadway?
Right.
I said, man, great. Can I hide behind you as when we get to the door and hopefully not pay any admission? He said, sure. So we get up to Smoke. It's cold. It's freezing. It's January. There's a long line in front of people waiting to get in. Uh-huh. And it's Jimmy Cobb's birthday bash. Cobb's mom. Jimmy Cobb. It's basically full. Mm-hmm. The doorman sees Craig and me, and since we were musicians right away, he tells us to wait over on the side, and he gets all the customers in. Then we're last. He waves us over, and he says, okay, gentlemen, that'll be $40 per person, a two-drink minimum, da-da-da. And I'm going, oh, my gosh. And I'm looking at Craig Handy. Like, aren't you Craig Handy? You know, yeah. I've been out in the loop, so, you know. We just looked at each other. Okay, man, okay. Show us to a table, dog, on it.
Right.
To a table, the band's killing, watching Jimmy Cobb, the whole deal. Being in New York again, first day in New York. And now it's time to pay the bill. It comes over with the bill. The bill is equals $75 a piece.
Okay.
Right. $75 a piece. That's what the tip and everything. We're bumming. Just then, Craig Handy looks at me and says, no wonder I don't hang out anymore. It made my heart sink. So what I got for that was, oh, I see. So I'm not supposed to be hanging out. I just stayed.
Yeah.
And my heart sunk when he said that.
Oh, no.
We paid our bill, and we're walking out the door.
Uh-huh.
Just as I get my hand on the door, the owner of the club yells from across the club, hey, Tommy. You want to do the last show, the 12 o'clock midnight show? We can pay you $80.
Yes! To pay for my hang.
Absolutely. So I did my first gig in New York.
That night.
I made $5. $5!
That's so
now, after going, you know, after being there for a year or two or something like that, maybe even three, starting to get around, you know, playing with older friends of mine and new ones, and kind of getting back on the scene.
Right.
And now, you know, I'm trying to show them what I got, you know, from who I learned from, you know, Kenny Washington, Bill Stash, you know, Tane, all the Al Foster, all the cats, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Thing I got, you know, I'm trying to make it work, you know, please everybody and, you know, keep everybody interested and mm-hmm. surprising. I guess, obviously, I hit a point. I was on the gig, and I was doing this gig with a vocalist, and I realized I had a little opportunity to maybe pull this out.
And out came.
Probably brought one pig to the first gig. And, you know, probably my bass pig. Just my bass pick's got real love, especially with Mike. Or not, if you're in a small club. Okay. It's got wings and stuff. These pigs have been all over the world, by the way.
Just amazing.
Like Australia, Brazil, everywhere.
Yeah.
And so I pulled it out, and you know, after taking a couple of traditional solos and whatnot, you know how you run out of ideas.
Yeah, yeah.
Third set, and you know, you play the samba, a ballad, a song in three. You lay it out. You traded fours. You've
done it all. Yeah.
Ballads, chimes. You know, that background. I love you. I love you. Right, right. Hey, shucks, I'm out of ideas. So pull out the big. Then, you know, being in it's here's the thing is about that, which I learned from Dizzy. They hold two sets, three sets. I'm filled with music, and they just about seen everything that they're going to see. And right. Then, bang, bang. So, it's a surprise. It really is a surprise. If I do say so myself, people know about it now. But when I was first doing it,
they're like, why?
Like the heel toe, you know. Heel toe and the hi-hat, you know. Not many people were doing it. But of course, when you start doing something and you think it's new, it starts to take off. That's when you realize that other people are doing something similar. Or if you go farther enough,
right?
Now,
right.
You know, you think that you're the only person that can play hi hat with your teeth. Ah, 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 ah. And you got a new idea. You know, you got a new thing. You know,
right.
The tooth hat, or you know.
Yeah. And suddenly,
yes, and then you break down, you recorded your first record with or whatever.
Your teeth.
You know, your teeth are wearing down by now, you got like three dentists. You know? And sure enough, somebody else is playing the ride cymbal with their teeth or whatever. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's different, but you know. Last but not least, as far as this goes, some people look at it as a joke. Some people look at it not being serious at all. Some people welcome it, you know, like, oh, animals.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Especially women. Yeah. They love little squeaky, squawk little.
And they're cute.
Right. That's the word.
They're cute.
And it all depends on the face that you show them. I got all these different faces, you know.
Yeah.
And the closer you're sitting to it, you know. So, you know, one thing at least, so it's very entertaining. But at the same time, it's very, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know. Yeah. So, Dizzy, definitely Dizzy Gillespie, first and foremost. And I love Billy Higgins had a smile when he played, man. That's part of his trademark, man. Even if the police were after him.
Even if.
Smiling, y'all ain't gonna catch me, man. But you know, seriously, you know, Billy Higgins had a smile. And people have told me about that over the years, you know. So, you know, as we get older, you know, we pulling from everything, man, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's great. I think it's the best. And like you said before, you even had it on the Jimmy Fallon show at one point.
Right, right, right. Where a lot of people saw it, and I was getting all kinds of emails, texts, and Instagram messages, and Tommy, can you play here and bring your Porkestra show? You know, I was booked, man, after the Fallon show.
Yeah, yeah.
And then 2 weeks after, I got smoked.
Well, that'll come back.
Oh, it already did. Man. My life is better now than it was.
Yeah, absolutely. That's beautiful. So the last little bit I want to touch on is what's happening with you now. And one of the biggest projects is Vocal Eyes. That's been with you for many years. But is that one of your main things you're doing now?
That's definitely my pride and joy, my biggest. I love vocalists. You know, thanks to Dizzy Gillespie especially, you know, I played with all of them from Ella Fitzgerald, Barbara McRae, Betty Carter, you know, Nina Simone. And so I was able to, Roberta Flack, he never played with Roberta Flack, but hung out with her a lot, you know, because she was so. And I'm a big fan of vocals. I really am. Vocal stuff. And so, and then playing with the Manhattan Transfer, I kind of got a chance to see how it works more and what's involved. And then I started my band and asked Janice Siegel to get the group along with Miles Griffith, who was from the John Hendricks camp.
Right, right. Wow,
and,
that's great.
And boy, they were. Oh, man, I have Andy Davis on bass, Alain Millay on piano, Jerome Harris on guitar. And all my friends, we had chemistry, which is so important.
Yeah.
Yeah, when you play with good chemistry, it doesn't hold up to names and brands.
Yeah, you know, it's its own thing.
Yeah. You know, well, when you got some chemistry, you go on places, boy, buckle up. So I got a lot of experience and a lot of help from them getting this off the ground. I wrote, thanks to Berkeley, I was learning how to write arrangements and stuff, and wrote a few arrangements. Mm-hmm. I play, we do different things. You know how vocalists challenge drummers, you know, how we have to always be right there.
Yeah.
What they need. Always challenging and fun and rewarding.
Right.
I get a chance to write for vocalists and
right. Switch it around.
I have them singing ostinatos with lyrics in, you know, in different meters or just in four, but then, you know, and I'm playing a solo over it. I do that a lot. And, you know, I reverse the, you know.
The roles, haha.
Yeah. And so some songs I might write 10 lyrics, but three choruses of melody, and they have to improvise the lyrics into the situation that they're in, you know.
Okay.
A lot of creativity involved.
That's fabulous.
Some songs I'll write 12-note melody, but three choruses of lyrics.
Okay.
So you have to sing the lyrics, but improvise the melody to fit the chords and sing the lyrics along.
Wow. So you really push it.
Some songs I have, it's required that at these sections, no singing. No singing. Only dialogue. I want you to talk this whole situation. There's a song that I wrote called Selfish Fella, where the two vocals talk about how selfish they have to create a little
drama.
Yep, drama. I have a lot. I have at least four songs where they.
Oh, wow.
And this another one's called "You Must Be Crazy." Mm-hmm. Another song of mine, and they dialogue in the beginning, you know, and one vocalist is talking to the other, just some crazy. You got this. You wear your hat backwards and your shirt on backwards. You know, I love it. You know, and. You know, you hear with your eyes and you see with your ears, and you're crazy, you know. That kind of stuff.
Right. Amazing.
And that's always different, you know.
Right.
There's two songs that I borrowed from my great friend Ray Anderson, who's an incredible musician, mm-hmm. who I played in his bands. Mm-hmm. We have a long history. The Prius, my most fun gig, artistically, would be Ray Anderson.
Okay.
You can do anything you want, just make it quality, no BS. Play like you mean it.
Right.
Whatever you play, we'll make something out of it. Creativity at its finest. Wow. You know, there's other bands. I'm just giving you one example. This is my favorite. And it's nothing like being hired to do what you do, you know?
Right.
And in this struggling, never mind the COVID, but you know how you got to kind of make a living. Mm-hmm. You know, you play weddings, bar mitzvahs, you know.
Yeah.
Feelings, you know.
Just to get some money coming in, yep.
Yeah. You know, so when you get called, and sometimes a lot of people are fooled thinking that they're being called to do what they do, when actually, go ahead and, you know, go ahead and get through out and see what happens.
See what happens.
And yeah. Other than that, you know.
Yeah.
Stopping at the bit just waiting for you.
Right. He's outside the door with his drums.
You know, some people think that what they do is... some people are kind of coaxed into thinking that they're doing it because this is what they want to do. But mm-hmm. they've been doing it so long and they're so happy with it that they feel like, but really there's restrictions still, you know?
Yeah.
You don't want the club owner to walk out and yell at you, you know?
Right, right.
Those groups that you don't make any money, but you create beyond, you know, mm-hmm. where you're asked to do anything you want. Mm-hmm. Just stop in the middle of your solo and scratch your butt if you commit.
If you commit.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
But you know, as artists, we like to go around. I like to play commercials. I love club dates, man, with a good band, man, playing all that.
They're great.
Ah, and kicking. Only classics. Oh, yeah, I love it. Yeah. So we love it all, to be quite frank. But I just thought I would.
Yeah, I love that. That is gold. Believe me, that is gold. So I guess we're kind of coming to the close of this adventure.
Wow.
You know. So I guess you asked me before we started this that you wanted to make some special shout outs to some folks, because I know you've been through a whole lot in the last little bit, especially. So, yeah, I'd be glad for you to do that.
Well, some I mentioned, you know, through our talking, of course. I'll uh-huh. try to circle back. I know I'm going to miss, some for sure, you know, but starting here, from here on back, you know, influenced by a lot of great people. I knew that they were great, but, you know, when you really get to know them, you really find out that
how great they are.
Nuances and things that aren't related to music, you know.
Right.
And they're, you know what I mean? So, all my friends who helped me at my start, you know, like Kevin Eubanks and Jerry Moore, and, you know, my... so many close friends that guided me, of course, my teachers, you know, at Berkeley, you know, that was a gas. It really was. One of the highlights of my life was being a student at Berkeley.
Oh, that's great.
As cheesy and corny as it might sound these days.
No, not at all.
And actually, Roger Brown, the president of Berkeley, was my drum student.
Oh, wow.
So, when I was teaching at Berkeley, for 3 years.
Uh-huh.
Roger Brown came in off the street and wanted to take lessons. Later, I realized, you know, he was voted into, he was sought after to be the president, the new president of Berkeley.
Amazing.
So we're good friends, and, but, you know, the Jazz Foundation of America was a huge help when I got beat up, nice. And John Lee was just amazing. Spearheaded the whole recovery for me. Mm-hmm. Donnelly and Frank Wilton, who started the GoFundMe, which made me realize how many people love me, which I had no idea. I thought I had some friends, man. A lot of people who I played with, my closest, you know, friends of the Mavis organization, mm-hmm. they helped. They were there a lot. People like Santi Demiano and dear lifelong friend, Curtis Warner, of course. You know, my company, who I say my companies, but these people you know, I'm older now, so the people that I knew at Zildjian and Pearl and Dick Burt and Evans, Gomez, you know, some are still there. You know, I knew Craigie Zildjian when they were just kids. Mm-hmm. I was a kid, but they were really kids, you know.
Yeah.
They would come by, you know, come to Zildjian, have lunch, you know, with their dad and, you know.
Yeah.
Dick Burt, I knew not only hanging out with Dick and Dick helping me and guiding me, but, you know, I knew Kelly and Tracy Burt and, you know, well, you know, as kids, you know, as Dick's kids.
Yeah.
And so everybody, you know, except for the Pearl industry, who was always so big to begin with, they were always the hardest, you know. Mm. In the drums, of course, if you're playing with Sonny Rollins, Van Halen, Transfer, John McLaughlin, and, you know, Jeff Eubanks, you know, you snap your fingers and your stuff is there, you know.
Right.
But, you know, let life take a turn, and, you know, you really need help for yourself, you know.
Right, right.
That's when you find out, you know,
who's who.
Or who will help you, yeah. You know, for whatever reason. It's special now.
Yeah.
It's like you find out who your friends are. And Ray Anderson, I got to, you know, got to give a big shout to him. We met in New York 1977 at a recording studio doing a record for Bear Hershey in the Year of the Year. And, man, and later I, you know, started following him. You know, he played with Anthony Braxton and had his own group called the Syncophonics.
I remember Syncophonics, yeah.
Oh, man, what a band, man.
Oh, it was great.
Park Elias on bass.
Yeah.
And so he's been over the years, you know. The people who I just mentioned of course I'm missing somebody, you know, of course. But, you know, my family, you know, my sister, my late sister.
Yeah. You took me to her house. I met your sister.
What?
Yeah. Yeah, she was lovely. Yeah.
Wow, man, yes. Rocky Bryant also got a shout out to him. He's a great, great friend. Yeah, man, you know, my sister, that's amazing, man.
Yeah, she was great.
Incredible, wonderful, incredible woman. Mm-hmm. Who left us too soon.
Yeah.
But she really helped me in many ways. We were so opposite. We were really kind of opposite in many ways, not always. But. And so you were at her house in Marlboro?
Yeah, we were. I drove one weekend and we hung out, and you were playing with your band in Boston. Yeah, you had, like, it was like Baron Brown on bass, and the keyboard player that played on Sundance.
Gary Atkins.
Yep. And who else?
It wasn't Kevin?
No, it wasn't Kevin. You know what? I think it might have been a trio.
I think maybe it was Randy Roos. Isn't that one trio with Gary Atkins was playing? It could have been, but looks like he
I can't remember who the guitar player was. Can't remember.
And we played a lot with Randy Roos last week.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, that was the band, and we hung out all weekend. It was a blast. You know, sat in and everything. It was great.
Wow.
Yeah.
You sat in on the gig?
Yeah.
Oh, God. Yeah. It was the iPhone 10, man. I'd be like...
Yeah. But, man, all I can say is, like, the stuff you laid out today was so fantastic. It was, like, for a lot of people... it was almost like a bit of a history lesson, some of the stuff you brought up, you know. And I think the folks who come to Aubrey Drum Lessons are really going to appreciate this and appreciate you as I do. And I can't thank you enough.
I can't thank you enough, really, man. You know, it's been a gas just being face to face again after
it's been so long too. We don't, you know, I can't wait till the borders are open and the world's different from now, so we can actually see each other again in person. You know, so
I like to say hi to a special friend, speaking of the borders being closed. This man, a new female friend from before. And we've been having what's the term? Virtualness.
Virtual. That's good. That's great. All right.
So life is good, and everybody's moving
with
the punches, man. I can't believe I'm in a new relationship.
That's
great. I haven't
been out
of my house in four months.
Yeah, jeez. Amazing.
I couldn't buy my girlfriend before this pandemic. I was out just walking around. Hey, I'm available.
You know? Now. Well, man, it's great to see you so happy. You know, so happy and doing so great. And we will see each other soon. Thanks for watching my video. Really glad you did that. Subscribe and click here if you want more performance and lesson videos.